Well, hey there, nerds. So before this video begins, we have a big shout out, big thank you to our sponsors this time around. Yep, that's right. We got one in the form of Seven Deadly Sins, Grand Cross. Grand Cross is a new turn-based RPG based on the anime and manga Seven Deadly Sins. And if you're not too familiar with this, don't worry. The game follows the anime and manga story beats pretty faithfully. So you'll be joining Meliodas, Bon, Elizabeth, and most importantly, Hawk, as you travel the countryside forming your own band of Seven Deadly Sins. You'll also be doing a lot of other things like quests and trying to summon new characters, or maybe just managing your bar, even though people don't seem to like your food. And of course, there's always battling. And yes, this game does match the high kinetic energy of a lot of the action within Seven Deadly Sins, and it does a great job of implementing an intensive and strategic battle system in the form of cards and turn-based battles. So why not try out Grand Cross? It's coming out. You can check it out in the description below. Have a lot of fun and maybe, just maybe, pet Hawk. All right, on to the video. Well, howdy there, nerds. I hope you're having a fantastic day. And as you can tell by the title of this video, it's going to be a top 5 list. So, heroes have been added over the last year. Some crazy ones, some absolutely broken ones, but when it comes down to heroes, there are still some units that are missing from their games that I'm sure a lot of you may want to see in the future. So join me as I recount my top 5 units I want to see in Fire Emblem Heroes. Maybe post them in the comments, tell me which ones you want to see. So let's do this as improperly as possible. 5. Alright, so for the first one here, we have to start off with a little bit of hype. So of course we're going 3 houses, and originally when I imagined this video before the Fae channel, I was going to include her at number 5. That would of course be the lovely Lysithia. Because let's face it, she has many traits that I think a lot of us really share. She doesn't like ghosts. I mean, let's face it, who doesn't? I don't want to be around those spooky spooks. She also likes candy, which who doesn't? And of course, she has the tendency to annoy the hell out of Chaz Aria LLC. But sadly, thanks to the Fae channel, we now know that she seems to be coming sometime in the future, considering the fact they've already animated a sprite for her. And I would give the number 5 spot to this next character if she would come out of her room. Bernie, are you in there, sweetie? You can come out now.
What? I don't talk to strangers.
Seriously, we need you in Heroes. Come on. Seriously, a lot of people voted for you. Come on, come join Heroes.
I'm just gonna hide in the fort and cheer everyone on. There, is a fort, right?
This is gonna be a while, isn't it? Well, sadly, Bernadetta will not be joining us, but she still is number 5. And eventually, just eventually, I'm sure we'll see her in Fire Emblem Heroes. Seriously, Bernie, open up. 4. Now, this character hails from Fire Emblem The Blazing Blade, or Fire Emblem as you know it in the States. And when it comes to Fire Emblem, there's usually always a character that you have that you stick with and keep until the end game completely. And that is where Sane came in for me, and by lesser margins, Kent as well. But Sane was the cavalier unit I could really rely on when I needed it. Sure, he came from the typical Cain and Abel archetype that many Fire Emblem games had before him. I mean, come on, his name is literally one letter away from it. And yes, he does try to come across as a ladies' man, meaning that he's constantly flirting with people. And I'll just admit that this comes off as a wee bit creepy. Okay, quite a bit creepy. Much so that I actually prefer his support with Kent over, well, anything else, just because I like that dynamic a little bit more. And I will say when it comes to Sane as a character, I prefer him more as a unit than as an actual character. However, he still proves himself to be a pretty strong knight and can really do no wrong, at least on the battlefield. Personality aside. I'm not even gonna talk about that. Let's move on to the next one, shall we? I can't count this high. Ah, the Tellia Saga. It's filled to the brim with so many characters that I would just love to see in Heroes who aren't yet, like Immortal Dragon Daddy, the Sick Man, and I have no idea what the hell this is. But there is one character that they just keep glancing over, despite the fact that they've already added his brothers. I'm of course talking about my Boyd, by which I mean Boyd. It's really quite odd, because now we have Oscar, who's been added to the game for quite some time now. He's a pretty stable cavalier unit. Then we have Rolf trying to do his best Charlie Brown impression, and now, for some reason, we still don't have our big old Boyd. Is it because he's the middle child? Is that what this is? Now let's just be clear here. Boyd is kind of dense. He's a little bit of a meathead when it comes to actually being out there and understanding things, unlike, say, his brother Oscar, but still, he's proven himself incredibly reliable when it came to Path of Radiance, at least, allowing himself to just basically one-hit or two-hit most units that would come up against him, while still managing to at least take a hit or two without, you know, completely dying and collapsing on the ground in a muddled heap. And I have to say, he's especially hilarious when it comes to some certain supports. I'm looking at you, Titania. I'm not really sure that's how you handle a situation there, Boyd, but good on you for trying, I guess. Good on you for trying. But let me just say before we wrap it up with Boyd that there was one moment in my game that just sealed the deal for him. On chapter 25 of Path of Radiance, I accidentally sent him hurtling straight towards a bunch of boulders, not realizing how they would curve or how they would come down the mountain, and it was one of my biggest mistakes I've ever made. The boulders that hit him took about half of his health. I was worried that he was going to die, and somehow, some way, not only did he manage to dodge both attacks from two units, he managed to kill one of them without much of a thought. It was amazing, and I really wish I actually had a recording session of that, just to commit that to memory, because, oh boy, that was one of my favorite sessions in the entire game. Alright, but enough about Boyd, let's focus on another character, shall we? Now, this one is going to be a bit more interesting, because it doesn't necessarily just rely on the character, but also his possibilities when it comes to heroes.
I've lost count.
So, let's go all the way back into Fire Emblem history, all the way back to Shadow Dragon, and one particular character whose archetype I don't think we've ever seen return when it comes to Fire Emblem. Now, for those who are not familiar with Zane, he is a Manakeet. Think something like Noe, but probably not going to jail just by looking at him. Zane gave up his Dragonstone, and because of that he doesn't transform into a dragon. Oh no, he is what is called a Freelancer. And this is where things get really interesting. Much like a dancer who has their own skill on the battlefield, he too has his own special ability. He can imitate pretty much anyone he chooses, and I mean turn into them, become exactly as they are. Movement types, weapon capabilities, all of what you can think can happen, he can transform into. Granted, some abilities like Dance are still not available to him, but let's just say you happen to have a really powerful unit on your team, what would make that better? I know, how about two of them? Now, I can't imagine this possibly working in Heroes at all. I'm pretty much assuming that if he were ever to come out in Heroes, they would just slap him with a generic dragon build and call it a day. But it's really interesting to see a skill pretty much forgotten about after its initial conception. And as for Zane himself, oh, he's a mischief maker, as you can only imagine what Imitate will allow him to do. And when he isn't busy teasing Tiki at all, which also, by the way, quite adorable to see those two interact, he also enjoys giving the nickname Princey to Marth. Zane is quite a lovable character in his own way, and I would really love to see him brought into Heroes in any form. But I would really love to see Imitate brought into the fold. Could you imagine what chaos this would bring to the game? Ah, it would just be so amazing. Well, with that out of the way, I think it's probably time to move on to the last character, number one on my list. Are you guys ready for it? I'm sure you may know where this is going, and yes, we're going back to Tellius. Hey, we managed to make it to one. I'm so proud of us. You know what? I think it's about time. I've decided. Let's go for it, guys. You guys have helped me along with this. Path of Radiance has quickly become one of my favorite games, but, well, I haven't really played much of Radiant Dawn in the long run, so, you know what? Damn it all, we're gonna buy that game. You know what, guys? After a lot of thought, I've decided to start a petition to try and get Radiant Dawn onto the Switch. So while we try to wait for that one, let's talk about our number one character. That, of course, is Jill. You know, it's not oftentimes when it comes to Fire Emblem that I actually see a character who kind of, well, transforms over the course of the story. I've seen characters roar at each other in dialogue, or ninjas just kind of sit there and stare at each other. I'm not really sure what's going on here, but hey! But Jill is an exciting character just because of how she becomes a better person over the course of the game. When you're first introduced to her, she is, what's that? Oh, I can't actually say the word? Let's just go with prejudice, then. Throughout most of her childhood, she was taught that Lagoos were, in fact, subhuman, and they were not to be treated with any sort of humanity at all. It also doesn't help that her family, namely her father, were more often forced into Lagoos hunts. But the beauty of it with Jill is that you get to see her in Ike's company, and she gets to experience firsthand what Lagoos really are. And she starts to realize that maybe her prejudice is not exactly as strong as she thought it was. And when it comes to growths, it's not only story-based where Jill really excels. Although maybe I tended to use her too much as a taxi service when it came to her flying capabilities. And I can tell why people enjoy Jill, just because of how she transitions from story into gameplay and beyond. It's a fun little adventure, and I really hope she finally manages to make her way into Fire Emblem Heroes as a strong, capable flying unit. And I haven't even gotten to experience her in Radiant Dawn yet, so I'm pretty excited to see what lies ahead for her. And that about wraps it up when it comes to the characters that I want to see in Fire Emblem Heroes. But as I said before, I want to know what characters you want to see. Are you hyped up for what the next year will be, for what units we might get? I want to know in the comments below. Now, if you don't mind, I'm going to go back to knocking on a door, because she's still not out of here. Come on, Bernadetta, what the hell are you doing? Bernie, you there? Come on, open the door. We have cake. I promise, not a lie, there's actual cake here. I promise, no one will hurt you, except maybe the owl. I don't know where the owl is. Why are you people still watching me pretend to knock on this door? It's kind of getting weird, you know.